think about it for just a moment. When was the last time somebody called you up or was next to you and asked you for something? What was your immediate response? Think about it. What happened to you respond to that ask? Or when you were called? Was it like, oh no, then again? Oh, why did you call me? In so many ways, depending on how you reacted or how you responded, could be a indicator of how you are responding to God. Can I get an amen? Sometimes we give God a cold shoulder. Sometimes we even get sort of consumed in ourselves and we don't ask God for just a minute. Sometimes we get sort of wrapped up into our things and our stuff. And so sometimes we don't even know God may be calling us. Sometimes we get so busy being busy bodies that we don't even know what God may be wanting us to be busy for Him about. In so many ways, we think about how God is calling us, and the scriptures are laden today with the message and the imagery of how God may be calling you to consider a new way of thinking, to consider a new way of seeing, to consider a new way of loving. How many of us see and love and hear perfectly? Raise your hand. Still looking. Scanning. No one. How many of you are willing to work on and allow the Holy Spirit to move you a little bit more and open your heart just a little bit more? Open your eyes a little bit more. Open your ears a little bit more. I think of married couples. Married couples are continuously calling upon each other to help one another. That's why you're called a helpmate. Can I get an amen? But sometimes spouses, unfortunately, get so caught up in their stuff that the other one sounds like that teacher in Peanuts that goes, wah, 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 wah. Sometimes spouses turn off, and even if you get older, they got to hear me. I didn't hear you, honey. I'm so sorry. But sometimes we are called to be better in our loving, in our caring for one another, in our expressions of God's love and mercy to those who are even close to us, such as spouses, family members as well, children. Sometimes we get caught up. You can get caught up into your stuff, into your social media, into all those things that all your friends may be doing, that you forget who you are. You may forget your values. You may forget what your family is trying to teach you. Because everybody over here is doing it. Everybody over here is saying it. Everybody over here is praying it and texting it or however. And so sometimes we can get sort of into our sauce. We become the sauce of all the worldly pressures and the peer pressures when we forget about who we really are and what God is calling us to do and how may God be calling us to live. Can I get an amen from teens? Amen. They're like, oh no, God, this is up. But in so many ways, God is calling us. He's not just calling us one time and that's it. Imagine the apostles when they got the call to be an apostle. And that's what happened with Jonah and the Ninevites. He couldn't stand those tribes. He couldn't stand that people. He thought they were farthest from God. And so God's talking to this prophet and telling him, if you can convey to them that I can forgive them, if they would just repent and turn away from their sin, you go and tell them, I will not carry out the punishment that I have assigned them. And guess what? Jonah said, damn God. God is more kind and more compassionate than we can be. And so it says, Jonah, I'm sending you to go to the Ninevites and to warn them and give them an opportunity to repent. Jonah does what? He gets on a ship on the way to Joppa, and he goes away, and he goes the opposite direction. Literally, sails the opposite way. And what happens? He happens on the ship. They enter a horrible storm. The storm came away. The captain says, all right, who of you messed up with your relationship with God because our boat's about to go down? And so Jonah was like, oops, it was me. I shouldn't be here on this boat, but I am because I don't want to do what God wanted me to do. Okay, and what does the captain do? Boop! He kicks him off the ship. He has that water point. And so he's off the ship. God, with providence, takes a big fish. Swallows him up, spits him on the shore of where? Nineveh. Oh, God, the same city. And so he spits him on the very shores of Nineveh. And what does Jonah end up realizing? Okay, here I am, Lord. I'm called to do this. So it takes 3 days to cross through that city. 3 days. Imagine that, walking through a large city in these 3 days. But everybody starts to take note of how Jonah is very much concerned, very much aware of the people needs to know this message of repentance. Turn away from sin, and the Lord will save you. The Lord will redeem you. And so the word got out in the city to the king. And the king got word and told everybody, we don't know that in their life. What this prophet is saying, we're going to adhere to. We're going to change our hearts, we're going to change our lives, we're going to go over it. Even the animals will sackcloth. I mean, everybody, sackcloth, that's everybody, the whole people. And God relented on his punishment for the Ninevites. In other words, never look at your life as something that no one can learn or grow from. God is calling each and every one of our lives to be a lighthouse so that other people can see God and hear God's truth. You might be happy, you might be given a message that a whole generation. If you open your heart to what God may be trying to say to you, and maybe God may be calling you to. In other words, the prophet Jonah has lived a whole other life, didn't want anything good for that whole nation. But God called him into mission, called him into service, called him to be a prophet, a mouthpiece, and what the whole kingdom was spared. You and I are different circles. You have people that I don't know, and I know people you may not know, but we're called to do as baptized Catholics, we're called to share the truth. We're called to share the light of God. Something that might be hard and difficult in this culture, this is a culture that we're living in right now, it's a culture of convenience. And if it's not convenient for me, I'm going to devalue you. If it's not convenient to me, I'm going to cut away. If it's not perfect, I will chop it off. If it's not the best, I will cut it away. That's what our culture in the United States does. It discards and cuts off things that are not things, but people. And the dignity that we're called to share, sometimes we don't see it because it doesn't fit our bill. It doesn't make it nice for me. It makes it uncomfortable. So I want to get away from it quickly. The truth is, all life is sacred. Somebody say, all life is sacred.
All life is sacred.
All life is sacred.
All life is sacred.
Even when we don't see it.
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 So there's a little boy, and he comes to his mom and he's having a play date. And she says, oh, baby, you are my child, even though I can't see you, my eyes are closed, but you're also my choice. And I'll always choose you over and over and over again. And then the little boy says, well, mommy, mommy, there's a lot of people that don't see me and don't see people, see children and babies, but they don't want to choose them. And I think a lot of times in our culture, because we don't see, because it might be inconvenient, it might be painful, it might be hard, it might be traumatic, but the gift of a child that's conceived is still a child. It's still a baby. It just needs time. That's the difference. All it needs is time, but it is still a child. Think of an acorn is that big. But in that acorn has all the information to be a tall oak tree. It is just given some time. It has everything in a soul. It has, or a child that's unseen, as we see in the world, has everything in it to be you and me. It is just given a chance. And it's just given a voice. I think of doctors, lawyers, I think of teachers, I think of people who are like you and me. You are children. You are chosen. And a lot of times, we didn't even know we were chosen. You know, amen. I didn't know my mom and dad were going to choose me. Why can't we do the same to others who we can't see? You're more than a choice. You're a child of God. And somebody may need you to step up. And I know the world is saying be pro this and pro that. And I'm not even saying that. I'm saying as Catholics, we have to start to learn how to see life as all life is sacred, even when you can't see it. I just want to encourage you. I've had a lot of amazing ministry to women, even in our community and beyond, who have had abortion. And they needed healing. They didn't even know they needed healing. They didn't even know they could get healing. They didn't even know the church could forget abortion. But God can. And the church stands ready to bring its arms around you if you experience anything like that. Or been a part of anything like that. And even if you have, God may be calling you to know that you're still loved. And that all life from the moment of conception, even to natural death, even to those we don't know, even those we don't get along with, even those who look different from us, God is calling us to love in a way that's greater than ourselves. So I just want to encourage you, if you even know anyone or someone, or if you experience the pain of abortion, we're here to heal and give you encouragement and a new direction in this new year onward. Let us be more than choice enough in our Catholicity. Let's be about sharing to children of God the dignity of everyone being persons from the moment of conception and judgment. Let's pray for the culture in our society that's a culture of inconvenience, a culture of extravagant self-reliance or independence. So let's pray that we can open our hearts to everyone. Honestly, a family member in my family tree wouldn't be here if her parents, because she was raped, would have allowed her to live. And it touches my heart today, because she was allowed to live. And now I have all my cousins. But honestly, it could have been because of rape, easily terminated, or easily thought of less than, or easily cut off. But God blessed that, my great-grandmother, to keep that child that she was given to by rape, so that our family tree could grow. Let us pray that our hearts may be softened to the mystery of God's love from those who we can see in our midst.